one fine morning, Thomas was just finishing his breakfast when Bertie came steaming into the shed, puffing with excitement. Thomas, he said, there's a group of really angry women coming through the railway gates, and they're carrying signs like, Thomas is a sexist pig, and ban Thomas. And Thomas reinforces sex role stereotypes. Give me a look, said Thomas. What a bunch of ugly lezzos. Now that's not quite fair, Thomas, said Bertie. They do have a point. For instance, why is it that only boys can be engines? Because I like having boys around me, said Thomas. Now come back into the shed and I'll show you my funnel. Later that week, however, the fat controller called a meeting of all the engines. Is everyone here? He called out. Alfred isn't here, cried Damien the diesel. Well, where is he? Bellowed the fat controller angrily. He's shunting Edgar in the maintenance shed, cried crazy Bartholomew, the local locomotive. Now settle down, said the fat controller. I've something very important to tell you. I have here an order from the Equal Opportunity Commission, which tells us that from now on, we've got to have female engines. The engines didn't like this idea at all. They booed and hissed the fat controller.
Boo, hiss, boo, boo, hiss.
3 weeks later, the first female engines arrived and everyone was surprised by how well they fitted in. In fact, Edgar and Toby even said that they preferred working with female engines because they had nicer couplings. Thomas could go either way. One morning, Thomas was taking it easy after a good night's shunting when he was surprised by a visit from the fat controller. He told Thomas that he was about to send him on a very special mission the next day, and that if he told anyone about it, he'd put his boilers in a vice and squeeze them very hard. The next morning, Thomas was attached to 6 mean and dirty old tank carriages. One of them said, What are you staring at, you poncy little pillow biter? Thomas steamed off until he came to an industrialized suburb and was directed to a disused warehouse where a couple of men in filthy overalls were waiting for him. They started to fill his tankers with purple slime from drums decorated with a skull and crossbones. Soon all the tankers were full and they headed off after one of the men gave the fat controller a large brown paper bag. The fat controller made Thomas pull the filthy tankers back out into the country, past fields and trees and flowers and birds, until they came to a lovely green field. The fat controller opened the valves on all the tankers and let the smelly purple slime ooze out onto the lush green meadow. As the sun went down, Thomas marveled at the beauty of the rural scene, as the river of purple slime glowed in the dark. A week later, Thomas had the numbers on his boiler changed. A low-income housing estate was built on the site where they dumped the purple slime, and the fat controller went on an extended holiday in South America. And everyone lived happily ever after. Thomas was very nervy and edgy this evening, rostered on the last western suburbs run from the city on Saturday night. He had heard terrifying stories about gangs of drunken punks in moccasins and was scared he wouldn't make it through the night with his boilers intact. Thomas had barely stopped at the first station when he noticed vile obscenities being drawn on the roof of one of his carriages. Okay, punks, he mused. Make my day. Quickly, he diverted himself onto the freight line, and before the young punk could duck, he was spread all over a low bridge. Eat soot, low-life scum, said Thomas. A large petrochemical plant loomed up in front of him. Let's party, said Thomas. Thomas let go of his two carriages and watched the storage tanks explode into two enormous fireballs, icing the punks inside and everyone else within a 500-meter radius. He suddenly felt very calm. No one ever gave Thomas any bullshit, ever again. Thomas woke up early one morning, looking forward to another hard day's work. However, a strike had been called that day due to a dispute over rosters and a series of outstanding claims on award restructuring, which had been presented to arbitration and had been referred back to delegates, who found the conditions unacceptable. So Thomas stayed in bed again. It was Thursday, and Thomas was sitting in the shed, calculating how much his 17% holiday pay loading would add up to if the arbitration commission backdated his log of claims to July the 23rd. After he did that, he went back to sleep. 2 weeks later, and the strike was over on the island of Sodor, and all the engines were back at work. Except Thomas had an RDO and took a day from his holiday leave to get a four-day long weekend. It was the Tuesday of the following week, and the fat controller asked Thomas to shunt Clarabelle out of the yard. Oh no, Thomas had done his back and his own work care. The fat controller is furious. Gordon, the union rep, called another strike, and all the engines went out again. One morning, Thomas and Percy and all the other engines were resting in the shed after a hard night's shunting. All of a sudden, Henry came puffing up excitedly and said he'd heard a rumor that the railway was going to be privatized. Thomas and the others rushed out to ask the fat controller what was going on, but he wasn't there. He had accepted a $250,000 redundancy package. They were greeted by a flash-looking fellow in sunglasses and an Italian suit. He stood on the platform and said to Thomas and his friends, "You're all being replaced. You're noisy and you stink, and it's time you were all melted down." Thomas and the other engines were so frightened by this that they fouled their coal boxes. Most of the engines were melted down and sent over to Japan and made into annoying little four-cylinder cars. Thomas wasn't so lucky. He was put in a children's playground in Randwick and ended his days covered in ugly graffiti, with possums shitting down his foot.